Well, I have with me the most reclusive Prashant Ruia of the Essar Group. Prashant, our annual meeting only seems to be happening in Davos every year, is it?
That's the only place you give me an invitation, so that's why I'm here.
How's the outlook looking this time on business and then on India?
Well, I can certainly say that this year in Davos has been very, very positive, especially for India. And we seem to be standing out as one of the few economies which is holding huge amount of promise,
right,
is actually talking about significant growth in GDP terms. And if you look around the world, given where Europe is and where other emerging markets, which we've as traditionally been bracketed with,
right,
and their state, you know, Russia, Brazil, Indonesia, then India is really standing out. And it's great after 3-4 years to have a Davos where, you know, everybody's positive about India again.
I know, it does feel good that everybody's talking about India with a big smile on their face.
Right.
Let me talk about individual business outlooks. Petrochemicals, so oil and petrochemicals in that sense, metal, steel, shipping. How are these businesses looking at this point in time?
So clearly commodity cycles are currently working, are down.
Yeah.
Commodity prices are down. Obviously, we've seen a huge drop in oil prices. But actually, from an India perspective, it's the best thing which could have happened, because we're one of the few countries which has actually benefited from drop in commodity prices.
Sure.
I think it adds, between oil and the other commodities, we're adding about $100 billion of lower money which one has to pay for imports of commodities. So I think that's really positive from India perspective. From a business perspective, at least in our case, we were not so much in the exploration or natural resources side. We've been much more in the value addition part of the cycle.
Downstream.
Yeah, in the downstream. So whether it's steel or whether it's refining or other sectors, power for that matter. And so we should be a beneficiary of lower crude or lower iron ore or lower coal prices.
Okay.
So I think it's gonna boost demand. Especially in India and other and China and other countries which import a lot of commodities. We've already seen a 20-25% drop in fuel prices and coal and all of the others. So it's going to fuel demand and that should ultimately be good for people who add value to commodities.
How much further or lower do you think metal prices will go? I mean, ferrous hasn't been hurt as much as copper, etc. have been. But do you see prices taking a big hit
further?
Yeah, from here on.
I don't know. I mean, we've fallen a lot. Even iron ore has come off close to 50%, 45%. Nobody can predict what's going to happen going forward. But I think the downside from here is much more limited. Compared going forward. But I don't know, maybe another 10-15% could happen, but hard to say. But supplies in the meantime, globally, people are still continuing to bring on the projects which they've invested in the last few years. So even in this year, we still see a lot more supply coming on,
which means that will continue to put considerable pressure on prices.
Yeah. So but at some point it will correct, and some capacities will go out of the market and the markets will correct. So we have to see what that point is. There's a lot of debate that below 60 shale oil is not viable, but it's already gone way below that, and shale is still
pumping
away. So we have to see.
Yeah. Okay. Fair enough. You've been in the process of delisting all your group companies from the Indian equity markets, as well as from London. Why is that, Prashant?
So, I mean, from our perspective, the company which we actually delisted was Essar Energy from the London market. And again, I think it was a bit of getting affected by what happened in India over the last 3 years, and especially in the sectors which we were, power sector, oil and gas sector,
and those sectors. Those things are looking up. Yeah. You're delisting last year.
So those,
now you're doing that with Essar Oil. Why?
So actually, Essar Oil is more of a corollary of the Essar Energy plan, and it was actually one plan, because Essar Oil is largely held by Essar Energy. We certainly felt that the kind of especially in London in Essar Energy the valuations were not in line with what the business should have demanded, and it was a strategic view from our point to take that company private.
It isn't that you prefer to be away from the scrutiny that public listed companies have faced, the regulatory issues, is that what has driven your decision? Because, you know, I keep recalling this conversation I had with Mr. Shashi Ruia many, many years ago when he told me it's too difficult to stay listed in a country. There are too many questions asked of you. It's much easier to do business as a private enterprise. And at that time, I didn't know he was being so prescient. You know, now in the last 6 years, I see you guys have pretty much fulfilled exactly what he was saying.
I think it's, I would certainly say it's true, especially if the public shareholding is a very small percentage. If you're, you know, the minority shareholding, especially in the international stock exchanges, and now the Indian stock exchanges are following the international stock exchanges, but the minority shareholding and the rights which are being given are certainly becoming very onerous for the majority shareholders. I'm sure this debate is on. It's going to be a lot more as the rules keep changing. But anyway, we felt it was, at least in the UK, for a very small minority share, we felt it was becoming very onerous. But that was not the main reason. That was one of the reasons. And then, of course, the...
When will you be able to finish the delisting of Essar Oil?
I don't have a particular date. The process is on. We continue to await some approvals. And once we
these are heavy approvals on a previous matter that sort of had to do with some bonds or something like that. So, no timeline is yet.
No. Okay. I couldn't
comment on that. Fair enough. You know, one of the other things I'm told you've been working on is the dollarization of your debt. Now, I'm just curious to know where you've reached in that process, how much further to go. And given the current environment of, you know, we're seeing the dollar get stronger, we're seeing rates potentially rising in the U.S. in the second half of this year, how are you re-looking at corporate finance?
Right. You know, basically, as a group, we followed a couple of strategies. One was bring the debt currency in line with the business. And most of our businesses are dollar-linked businesses, whether it's the oil and gas business, the steel business. And in a way, we were actually having debt in rupees revenue and earnings in dollars. So the from a risk prudent discussion, it was sensible to bring it in line. And most of our peers are actually already in dollars. So it wasn't something which is different from what the industry has followed. And the second one has been broadly bringing the maturity of the in line with the assets. And I think the Government of India and the Reserve Bank of India's policy, which they've recently introduced of 5x25, where they permitted, I think is a huge step in the right direction, because it really Indian companies were really at a disadvantage if you compare us with international companies because of this maturity mismatch.
Right.
And I think it's a huge step, and obviously we have welcomed that.
Okay, final question, because I know you're not very keen to talk about group issues, so to speak, but you know, let me put a broader question to you. What are some of the challenges that you're, you know, sort of listing as challenges that business leaders like you will face in 2015?
Well, I think, from a challenge perspective, we've been through a phase where we faced most of our challenges the last 3 years. Being in India, building infrastructure, you know, problems in environment, problems in land, I think we've had our fair share of challenges, and we've managed to navigate, I think, most of them. And I think now with the policies, most of the policies being set right, in the last 6 months or in the last 1 year, some of it in the previous government at the fag end, and a lot of it now in the last, after Mr. Modi has taken charge. I think from an industry perspective, from an investment perspective, clearly, we think the future is going to be strong, at least for the next 3 to 5 years. And the question really is, when does the new investment cycle start? It hasn't come in yet.
Yeah.
I don't see really too many large investments yet on the ground. But my own guess is in the next 2 or 3 quarters, you know, once the backlog, the pipeline gets cleared, one will see, much more ability of companies to.
So will that mean that your capex plan, which I'm told was in suspension of sorts, will also get reactivated?
Well, I don't think our capex plan was in suspension. We were focused on completing the capex plan,
okay.
And that plan got delayed by between 18 and 24 months for all the reasons I mentioned. That's now more or less completed.
Okay.
And so we're going to obviously enter a period of consolidation now where we put all those assets to work. Mm. And then obviously the future is, if what we are seeing and what we are hearing now continues, then obviously one will look
have
at...
Have you started planning already where some of the new capex could be?
I mean, you always plan, and you, being in the business for so long, you get a sense of what you want to do.
Why don't you tell us?
But no, I think it's a bit premature. Right.
Okay, we'll leave it there, Prashant.
Lovely.
Thank you so much
Lovely,
for supporting the cold.
Thank
and
you.
See you next hour.
Thank you.
Thank you.